I see Tommy's on.
Oh, yeah.
Whoa, he's right on time.
There he is.
Hi. How you doing, man?
I'm good, man. How you guys doing? I like the shirt, the green.
Oh, yeah.
Plastic.
Yeah. This is the 94.
Wow, it's in good condition. Very nice.
Yeah, it stinks.
Why? You don't do laundry? Because
it's, well, it's old shirt. You know, old shirt smell? Like, after, yeah. Like, it's got that. Like, the 27-year old shirt smell. But,
depends on the generation you're from. If you're a baby boomer, it smells like mothballs. And then if you're from the 60s, it'll smell like patchouli. Right.
I don't know what this... It's just that smell.
Is it like the cedar drawer smell?
It's just shirts.
Cedar drawers, yeah.
Yeah, like after... This is 27 years old, so like it has that 27-year-old concert t-shirt smell.
I love it. I love
it. So how are your shirts these days?
I've had to move to a larger size due to the pandemic.
Except for Tim, we all have.
Yeah, I'm.
I don't know.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
I'm gonna shut this closet. It looks like a terrible backdrop. So.
Did you see our backdrops?
I like the prong. Yeah, the prong. It's like a looks like better than our stage backdrops these days. It's just the size of the clubs we've been playing.
Tim, you're hired.
Yeah,
it's the AV guy now.
Yeah, right. I can hang HDTVs on the wall. Thank you very much.
Very good. Very cool.
All right, cool. Well, let's get.
Where are you guys from, by the way?
So we all grew up in the right outside DC area.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great.
We saw you. We saw Prong at the Bayou and a bunch of times, and probably Hammerjacks.
What was that equestrian Bayou. The equestrian center we saw him with the White Zombie?
Oh, Prince George's Equestrian Center.
Yes.
I don't remember that gig. I thought it was at the DC Space, or was it the
DC Space? Yeah.
No, it was some place.
Yeah, there was a weird center. Place.
Oh, okay. All right. I remember that gig. That was a bigger gig. Yeah,
when they bigger. Got popular.
Yeah, that was. I think
they would do shows with them, just local shits. Like, you know, go down to the 9:30, and we started doing shows outside of New York with them. So,
yeah,
before they got huge.
Right. It was Valentine's Day that year. Was it 94?
It was freezing outside.
It was freezing.
February. It was, yeah. It was
yeah, we were those so idiots that waited out after the show and waited for you to come out. And we would meet you afterwards.
Very stupid of you, yes.
Yeah.
Well, you came out, though, and we got to meet you. So.
Yeah, so now I live in Winchester, Virginia, which is like 30 miles outside of D.C., and... Keith is still in Fairfax, Virginia, which is about a 20-minute drive to D.C. And Tim is in West Virginia. And
Joe Morgantown, West Virginia.
Who's in West Virginia?
I'm in Morgantown, West Virginia.
Nice.
Yeah.
That's an intriguing state. That's like very interesting place.
Yeah. It's. We'll leave it there. Yeah, let's leave it there.
And Joe is in Hamilton, Virginia, which is just, it's a suburb of
it's a suburb of Fairfax.
No, it's pretty much, yeah. It is. Yeah.
So, and you're in LA now, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Which is terrible. But
is it?
I've been to LA and I agree. I didn't like it.
Well, I used to like it. I mean, first I hated it for a while. Then I got used to it. And then, I've liked it until the pandemic and all this nonsense that's going on. So it's been bad since then. Because, I mean, this place is completely shut down still. And it's got the worst COVID than anywhere else. So it doesn't really make any sense. Nothing's been open for 8 months. And they're still – now they're trying to have this – law where you can't travel outside the radius of your house for 2 miles.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I don't know how they're going to enforce it, but
yeah. Talk about lockdown. It's
nothing opened.
That's crazy.
It's really bad.
Damn.
You can't go anywhere. So it's just ridiculous. Anyway, on to better things.
Yeah.
Hold on to your butts.
right there to our immediate left, we have all the folks gathering for the annual Saxon concert.
You've got people who really are into the occult and into Satan. They're propagating Satan, and I think it's a devastating thing on our culture.
It calms me down.
What's your favorite total metal video?
Here's the funny part about metal. It's getting old. But you know what? Embrace it. I want to be that grandfather in the backseat of the car.
Could you turn on my station, please?
Such a fine line between stupid and clever.
And we're going to be at the Wilson Theater tonight with Slayer. You're going to be there too, right? Oh! Ah!
All righty. Well, welcome to Somewhere in Time podcast, everybody. Welcome to 2021. Welcome to a new year, which means we've got new albums to talk about. Well, new old albums to talk about. Albums from the year 1991. Before we get going here, let me mention somewhereintimepodcast.com is where you find us online. Get to our Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, all that good stuff. So go there, somewhereintimepodcast.com, and find all of our shit. So once again, I'm Eric. We've got Tim here.
Hello.
We got Joe here.
Great job, Eric, on not cracking up.
Oh, thank you.
I cracked up.
I know.
Sorry.
And Keith is here.
Hey.
And we're really, really excited to welcome this next guest. We're going to be talking about the album Prove You Wrong by Prong on this episode. And we've welcomed the person who's mainly responsible for that album, singer and guitar player from Prong, Mr. Tommy Victor.
Hi, guys. Thanks for having me.
Oh, yeah.
Eric, Tim, Joe, Keith, Knievel.
Thanks for being here.
Evil Knievel. I think we should call him that from now on.
Yeah, fuck you.
I guess you've heard that one before.
Yeah.
Yes. Oh, okay. A few times.
That's like,
you piece of shit.
Our last name is Ford. We've never gotten shit for that at all.
Right? Last time I got tires, the guy went, "Your last name's Ford?" And I said, "Yeah." And he goes, "You drive a Subaru?" And I was like, "Yeah." And he goes, "Oh, that's funny." Like, yeah, real funny.
You drive a Subaru?
I have a Subaru and I have a Ford.
He does have a Ford.
I told him that. I was like, "I have a Mustang also." He was not impressed. He's like, "But you have a Subaru." I'm like, "Yeah, okay." I do.
I just bought a new car recently, and I was telling these guys before, I live in LA now, and before the pandemic, and I have a new car for 6 months, and I got like 30 miles. Like, brand new. I can't even drive it. There's nowhere to go. I go to the supermarket, which is down the block, and that's all I've used it for. It's absolutely unbelievable.
Is it a Subaru?
It's a Kia. It's not a Ford nor a Subaru.
Oh, hey, I've got a Kia as well.
That's what Joe drives.
Which one you got?
A Soul. Kia Soul.
Okay, that's good bang for your buck.
It really
is. I'll tell you, I got something better. We got this new Seltos.
Yeah, that's what I want.
Oh, it is unbelievably cool.
Yeah, they look
awesome. The best little SUV. It is so badass. Anyway, I'm not working for Kia. I'm working for my own band.
Yeah, no worries.
I do want to say, guys, I feel bad for you with that last names that people give you shit about. I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, yeah.
I never hear any of that.
Jay Bond.
Yeah, right.
Every
Bond
day.
Is such a good name, man.
Thanks.
Ford Bond.
And then that guy.
And that other motherfucker.
Sorry, Keith. I didn't know that was a thing. I had no idea.
All right. Well, so we're talking about Prove You Wrong. Let's play a little bit of this album. We'll play this song.
Yeah. Good choice.
Yeah. Well, I can't play all of it, but I can turn it down a little bit. Yeah. We can
have Spotify these days. Anybody can continue from that.
Exactly. So the band at the time was obviously Tommy Victor, lead vocals, rhythm guitar, and lead guitar. Troy Gregory on bass and Ted Parsons on drums. And this was the first album to feature Troy Gregory.
And the only one.
And the only, yes. Sorry. First and only. That's correct.
Formerly of Flotsam and Jetsam.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. So that kind of leads me to my first question. So when did he come along? Like, where in the process of, because I know this album was pretty quickly after Beck to Differ. So he must have come in pretty soon after that.
I always regret this. It was a painful decision to part ways with our original bass player, Mike Kirkland, who pretty much reformed the band. I formed the band with him. And he was a lot older than us. I mean, we were like, Ted and I were very young, and then Mike was older. And we were on a tour with Pantera and then with Flotsam, and he just was not digging like the whole road thing, and it wasn't really working out that great. So we met Troy on the road with Flotsam, and we agreed on all our musical tastes were really similar. Like, we love like Killing Joe and a lot of like it's more like Celtic Frost, and we had a lot of agreement, and we figured that he was going to be really good. Like, he was younger, and you know, we bring a better stage show into the band. So
right,
he came right aboard. He made the decision while we were on the road with Flotsam that he was going to play with Prong, and we were going to bring him aboard and get rid of Mike. So I kind of regret that decision in a lot of ways, because I mean, I'm not going to get right into it right now. It's like, I'm not that crazy about the bass playing on Prove You Wrong, and I don't like the sound. I think it's sloppy, and Troy wound up, I love Troy. We're still really good friends. I see him when I go to Detroit, but it's like, you know, he became like a, like he got into drugs and was just like crazy maniac. Yeah. And then, you know, so it was almost, it was a blessing when he finally quit, because he felt that it was like, it was too much my band. And then he didn't last long in the group, but, you know, Mike, we should have never really got rid of him. And I feel bad about that to this day.
Yeah. Well, Troy also had, I mean, he's got writing credits on the album. Did he have?
Yeah, he did. He contributed to, I mean, I think there's a lot of good ideas on the record, and he was a great partner to work on songs with, et cetera. All the other stuff seemed, it was just the opposite of what we thought. We thought he was going to be like a solid performer and a solid bass player. And like, we weren't really worried about his input creatively. It just wound up be the other way. Like, he had a lot of ideas, and you know, that a lot of them we kicked out, we didn't use. But he was a good songwriter, and not a consistent performer and you know, band member.
Yeah. Well, you mentioned the production. This album was produced by Mark Dodson, which he also produced Beg to Differ, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. So,
which he did a way better job on than on Prove You Wrong.
Yeah, it sounds a lot different.
Yeah, I revisited it because of doing the podcast, and for, you know, in preparation for this, and all the feelings that I felt back then after I remember bringing it back home in Brooklyn and listening to it, and I'm like, what the fuck is this garbage? And I was like, we recorded the studio that we didn't even check out. We had a brand new A&R guy, and he sent it to this place, and the control room was like the size of Madison Square Garden. It's like, I had no idea what was going on in the mixes. I was like, I can't hear anything, dude. Like, with Dodson, he was just like, I was like, this sounds like shit. And he's like, oh, it's good, it's fine. He just wanted to get the hell out of there. And I finally took it home. It wasn't like, we were kids. We didn't know what the hell we were doing. Like, you know, we didn't think about, oh, maybe we should take this someplace and listen to it before we approve the mixes. And, you know, like, we didn't go through that route, and we didn't have the time and the money neither. It was like, and by the time I was like, this sucks, Mark Dodson was on a plane going back to England, and like, that was it. You know what I mean? It was just, I never was confident about it. And I listened to it again. And I even hear more shit that I'm like, whoa, dude, like, it could have been so much better. It's like well, I can't believe the stuff that he did on this thing.
If the production was better, would you like the, because the songs, I mean, look, me, this is probably my second favorite Prong album.
I think there's a lot of great ideas on it. And I think there's some really strong songs. And I feel there's a couple of duds on there too, but it's just, I've worked with better producers now as I've more later on in my career.
Yeah.
And, you know, I've been involved with other records, you know, a lot of records. And now I look back and I can't believe how much he dropped the ball on this thing where, you know, there's just a lot of details that weren't paid attention to that needed to be. And they, when you have a lot of fucking things that are wrong on a record and they start building up, it's like, whoa, man, the whole thing starts getting weird. And I think it comes across like with people's response and critics, et cetera, to that record. And, you know, it's just even Dime, but when Dime first heard it, Dimebag, he was like, dude, what's going on with the guitar sound, man? I was like, dude, I don't want to hear it. It's like, thank you for stabbing me in the heart. It's like, I lived with the pain of the guitar sound on that record forever, you know? And, you know, like, that's just like, you know, this guy's an older English guy, and he was, you know, he worked on Priest records and blah, blah, blah. And like, he was like, you know, he really, you know, I had a transistor head that like I wanted to use, which eventually I wound up using with cleansing. I used a transistor head like Dime was using.
Okay.
And, he was like, this is crap, absolute garbage. And he's like, you have to use a Marshall, you know, a Plexi, and that's all there is. And I was like, it sounds like shit, dude. And it's like, and he's like, you don't know what the fuck you're talking about. And like, that's like, that was the whole session. It was pretty much that. Man. It was like, I'm an idiot, and I didn't know what the hell I was talking about. And, you know, like, he was this British dude that worked with Glyn Johns, and I heard it fucking forever, you know?
I've always wondered that. Like, is it... You walk into a studio and do they say like, well, here's what you're going to be using. And this is how I get my sounds. Or is it like, we're going to try to get the, I mean, like the stuff that Terry Date does sounds fucking awesome. And you can always tell it's a Terry Date album. And I don't know
why.
Why is that?
Because he pays attention to the details. Like, nowadays you have, it's different. This is when we recorded with tape and it's like nowadays people have Pro Tools, you know, it's records are done for nothing in people's bedrooms. You guys know all about that.
Yeah.
And, you know, you don't, you had to play back in those days. You had to play everything and you had to make sure that the whole performance of a song was good, like by the band before, you know, it had to be a good performance, you know, like, you know, that's what you did many, you did 20, 30, 40 takes of a song before it was right. You know? Right.
Yeah.
But he didn't do it. He was like, as I look back, it was sort of like, oh, that's fine. Let's, you know, I couldn't. He was like, I can't wait to get out the fuck out of here and go to the bar kind of vibe, you know? Huh. So, and then, but as far as Terry paid attention to details, like, it's like, this is a snare sound. I don't care if it's spent 2 days working on that sound. I'm going to make sure that it's right before you guys do the whole song.
Yeah. Right.
And get it. It's like, You do a whole song and the take is fantastic and you're like, man, that sounded great. And it's like, oh shit, one of the mics is not working, you know, like, and that's what I mean. Shoddy engineering was that sloppiness was like, and I hear it on the record. I'm like, dude, what, you know, like, it sounds like the bottom snare mic was not on for that song. And like, the gate was wrong with, the threshold on the gate was not right when he mixed the thing. And like, what's up with the bass compression on this song? And like, all stuff like that. I'm like, what the fuck is this engineering shit? That's like basic stuff. That would never happen with Terry Date record. It'd be like, everything is dialed in precisely before you even drop a note, you know? And then we would spend, you know, like 2 days on a guitar sound. Is it perfect? Yes, it's perfect. And it's like, then we would do overdubs, you know? And then if you have, you feel good when those basic tracks are there. And then you can experiment. But it was like that, you know, the problem, that studio that we went to was a problem too with that too. Because Mark was great on Beg to Differ. And that record is awesome. And, you know, like we had a really good time and the band was well rehearsed and we just bashed it out. And it was, you know, it was just sort of the opposite on Prove You Wrong. Though the songs were good. Like I said, the band, you know, was tight. It's just like even some of the bass, I'm pretty happy with the guitar performances, although I went like, you know, I there's not a lot of soloing and I was starting to go to that route away from solos into more noise parts, et cetera. And I started that with that. Right. That's what I said, you know, and we wanted to be more alternative metal and more punkier a little bit. And like, you know, like Beg to Differ was more of a, I thought, a thrash metal record.
Right.
And, you know, but, you know, the bass on it is sloppy as hell. I mean, like, I just listened to it now and I'm like, it's just all over the place. Ted was fantastic on that record. It's probably one of Ted Parsons' best
performances. Awesome.
Yeah. He's absolutely out of control on top of his game on that. Mm-hmm.
Did he do more? I mean, was he focusing on double bass more then? Because, I mean, Irrelevant Thoughts has a full on double bass attack at the end. And I hadn't heard that from Prong up until that point, you know, when that album came out.
It was funny you mentioned that because we always had a single kit, and I don't even know if double bass pedals were a thing back then yet. I don't even know if they were invented.
I think they were. Yeah.
But he was always a single kit guy.
Yeah.
And then when we got our check of money to go buy gear to go in and record Beg to Differ, he says, I'm going double bass. It's going to be cooler. And I was like, fuck yeah. So then he started fucking around with it, like from Beg to Differ on. And then, you know, obviously Cleansing is all stripped down. It's like, there's a little bass, double bass on a couple of things, but not that much.
Yeah.
Well, the double pedal doesn't look as cool as it
does. It doesn't.
No.
I mean, especially for a trio back then, it was like, we needed the double kick, you know?
Yeah.
Now, you know, I mean, now I waver back and forth, you know, it's.
We could play a little bit of that end of that song. You just mentioned Irrelevant Thoughts. So let's fast forward to the end of that song.
Yeah. Do it.
There you go.
Yeah.
I love that song.
That is fucking
so powerful.
Awesome.
is that noise you're making, Tommy? Is that like your thoughts on the album's production now?
it's just like a lot of moments on that record is a poor Jazz Coleman from Killing Joke impersonation. Okay. that's what it is. So by the time the Zero Days came out, I finally was able to do that scream of his, but somewhat.
I love that. That's like one of the best opening tracks. I love that song.
It's so good.
I like it too. It just could have been heavier and better, and it just too. The treatment on the vocals. I mean, it's cool there, but again, I mean, after working on the records, it's like there's some lines, some things during the whole record that are like jumbled, and you know, producers, engineers these days, they know how to push up certain lines and you know, manipulate it. It's just obvious that he was just mailing in the mix in a lot of ways on the record, where just, oh, that's fine, I'm going to put compression on the whole track, and you know, if it doesn't pop at that point, who gives a fuck kind of attitude. It's like, instead of like sitting there and really making sure every part of your vocal comes up, or making sure the performance was good.
Right.
Like, we're paying a guy back then, these guys made good money. Yeah. And it's like, you know, for 3 weeks worth of work, he probably made like, you know, 25 grand. And it's like, you know, like be meticulous about shit, you know?
Yeah.
I listened to it back like, oh, well, okay, that sounds cool. And like the next verse, it's like, what's going on with the vocal on that? You know?
Yeah.
Well, you mentioned he was, you know, it sounded like he just wanted to get out of there. Was there any pressure? Because I'm sure coming off of Beg to Differ, that was probably your most successful album at that point, I'm sure, right? Because of all the Headbangers Ball playing their songs and things. So was there pressure from the record label or anybody like that saying, you really need to get a new album out there as quickly as possible? I've heard that from other artists where they're like, no, the record company just wants you to get in there and produce material as quickly as you can. Was there any of that going on?
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't sort of like, I read like one of these Black Sabbath biographies recently, and you know, and then it wasn't like that, but most of the songs were written like on the road, and like when I got home for a couple of weeks, it was a little bit rushed as far as the material, but that has nothing to do with the actual. I mean, we were rehearsed. We rehearsed the songs, and you know, there was a lot of changes at the label at that point too. The guy that signed us, Bob Feinagle, got fired, and we inherited. This is totally true. This guy Frankie LaRocca, the late Frankie LaRocca, and he had. Reject when we were trying to get record deals earlier on, He passed us on at Atlantic, and it was just like, well, now he's our A&R guy, and he was sort of like, you know, I don't know what he was whispering to Dotson, but he was not like a huge Prong fan, this guy. Yeah. So that sucked at first.
Yeah.
But his head turned totally changed around because with Cleansing was so successful that, you know, like, you know, he woke up then, and then he sort of got involved in Rude Awakening, and he sort of like talked too much on that, and that fucked that record up. But that's another story for another time. But Frankie,
we'll have you back to talk about that one.
Right,
Frankie was the one who wanted us to go to this Cajum Studios. It's called Cajum. I doubt it's still there. It's in Philly, and it was just it was a horrible place to do a record, and. You know, you hear that about like Never Say Die, like, you know, with Sabbath, like they went to the studio and they're freezing their asses off. And like they were up in Canada and like how, you know, like that record to me sounds awful. And like it's sort of like almost the same thing, you know, but has a lot to do with it. The vibe was just shit. It was terrible.
Yeah, gotcha.
And we were just eating cheesesteaks and just all fat.
Lots of grease.
So where do you stand on, I know, I think a lot of musicians frown on this, but I know I can speak for me and Tim and Eric that we like when bands sometimes redo their albums with new production and new musicians sometimes if they have to. Like Testament, their redos and the Anthrax redos. I mean, I love those albums. So has there ever been any thought
of... Which Anthrax record did they redo?
Well, they didn't redo one, but... They did. There was some,
well, they did some stuff with John Bush that was...
Yeah, when they re-recorded some of the older stuff.
Oh, okay. The Greater of Two Evils.
Yeah, great. Yeah. That's right. Yeah.
Yeah, they took old Joey Belladonna songs and re-recorded them with John Bush on vocals and put them out as a...
Some would say it's blasphemy, but we thought it was fucking awesome.
Yeah, we love John Bush's voice.
I love the originals too, but I love the new ones. I just like hearing the songs again, I think.
Yeah, so. I agree.
Yeah, the problem with that, I mean, how many... John Bush were going back a ways. Like, I know, like, and that's still at a time when people were selling records and, you know, to put out a re-release was maybe financially viable at that time. Now it's like, okay, for what? You know,
You make no money.
You're going to lose money if you do that.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Just for the three of us, at least.
For us.
No, I mean, re-record that record would be cool. I mean, it would be, I don't know what, like, Ted and I were talking about something, but I don't know. Ted had some health problems and he lives in Norway, but I would love, and Troy is out there. But I would have loved to do a reunion tour for that record for Prove You Wrong.
Oh, that'd be
it's
awesome.
Just that I don't know how financially we make it work, you know, like flying people in and, you know, these days it's just, well, now everything's shut.
Right, exactly. You can't do it now anyway. Yeah. Right?
Yeah, so. It would have been cool, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Hell yeah, I would love.
Everyone, they're all alive, you know. At least they're alive, you know. So
yeah.
Speaking of Troy, really quickly, I listened to some of his solo stuff, and I texted you guys. I was like, I mean, I kept listening to it, and I'm like, and don't I hope. Nobody takes this the wrong way, but I was like, this is the most awful thing I've ever heard. And at the same time, I freaking love it. It's just so different. Like, it took me so many listens to get into
it. Let it sink in. Yeah.
Yeah.
Which one? I mean, he's got like the witches and
let me see if I can pull it up here.
I try listening to, you know,
it was just so, it was so out there.
I'm terrible. I can't stand ever. Most shit I just don't like. You
know? Yeah. Well, while Joe's looking for that, you mentioned that there's, you know, the sound of the drums. I noticed immediately when you start playing Positively Blind, the snare sounds different immediately. Yeah. Like, it's a different snare.
Oh, you know, Ted with his piccolo snare back then. I was like, oh, yeah.
Is that what it was? Okay.
Yeah, I was like, oh, Jesus. Ted was like, fine.
That snare sound right there is just like.
Yeah, it's a piccolo.
Yeah.
So did he, I guess he was using different snare drums then on the album.
Yeah, probably on that, yeah.
Wow.
I mean.
It's an interesting choice. I mean, I don't know.
I always prefer the piccolo snare to.
I do not.
I like how bright it is. I mean, it's just.
Well, Ted was always had an affinity for dub music. He still worked with that and like reggae and dub music, and you know that's one of his loves. And you know, like it's just that seems to be part of this trip. You know, not my cup of tea.
Yeah, me either.
Well, it works in like reggae and stuff like
it's
that.
It's like but... 311. It's fine, you know.
Exactly. Yeah. Thank you.
It's not really the deal.
Didn't Sid in Overkill prefer that as well?
He had a very high snare. Yeah,
he did. Yeah.
I don't know if it was piccolo, but it was high.
Yeah, he did.
It's kind of unfortunate to hear your stories about this, Tommy, because I think we all love this album.
This was the album that got me the first Prong album I ever heard.
And there was no internet then, so we just bought the album and played it. And for us, like, I think we have this kind of nostalgic approach to it because we put it on, loved it, and didn't really think much of like the artist's dislike of it. It was just like, we just love this album.
We can't hear the mistakes.
It's the sequencing too, I have a problem with a little bit. I'm glad you guys like it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's different. I mean, compared to what Prong was always trying to be different, and I think we succeeded with that.
Yes.
Yeah. So, like, Make the Difference was way different than, you know, what the countless thrash bands were putting out at that
time. Oh, yeah. It stood out big time. Yeah.
Yeah. And then, like, this one is sort of in that mode, but it's just not heavy enough for me. It's like, it needed to be, but it could have been fucking, like, that's what's frustrating to me. I mean, I think that we were on the right track. There's a couple of real dud songs on there that could have been like out. and then like some of the vocals could have been more in your face, fucking crisp right there. The guitar sound could have been like in your face more, bass down, not so trebly. It sounds like Fieldy from Korn or something.
There's a lot of distortion on that bass.
It's like, I love the chord, like, the guitar is the bass, and the bass is like the guitar.
Right. Really.
It's like, bing, 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 bing. And the guitar is like.
But we were coming from like the 80s where every album you bought, the production was going to be a crapshoot. You know, you didn't know what you were going to get. So
yeah, there you go.
In a lot of ways, we just would look past it and just look at the songs.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think, especially the whole Tampa bands and all that. Some of the thrash metal, like the death metal records are like, huh?
It didn't matter because you're just like, I like these songs.
I guess you're right.
And production is kind of, it's just, it's okay. You know, it's like, it's okay. You know, it's fine.
It sounds better than a lot of
them. It's kind of reverby and muddy, but the songs are good enough to where we're like, it's fine. There's enough albums that sound weird.
I just think the mix is dainty and like this, some of the.
I mean,
if there was one word to describe Prong, it would not be dainty.
No, dainty's not the word.
It's relevant.
No, but I always have that in my head. It's like Dime coming up. Like, I forget what he's like. Yeah.
That would leave an impact on me for sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
I get that.
What's going on with this horse now, man?
Eric would have quit guitar.
Yeah. No. Well, and they had just done Cowboys from Hell, which sounds awesome. So,
yeah, right. Well, Terry Date.
Yeah, Terry Date. So, like, fuck you, Dime.
Well, I got to say.
Hey, look, it's aggressive guitars in your face is a necessity. Like, to be, like, you know, pompous and, like, you know, I'm not going to put the guitars so loud on this record.
Right.
Yeah, this, just for the sake of it, just to make a statement that, you know, or whatever. Yeah. It's just retarded.
And he also produced Sound of White Noise the year before.
He had a lot of great shit.
Yeah,
I know. Why did we get, why does Prong always get burned? It's like.
Son of a bitch!
So. I gotta say, when at the end of Unconditional, I don't know if it was on this tour or the next tour where you started the ending. You slowed that riff down.
Oh, right? I love
like,
that!
Like halftime or was even less.
Yeah,
it's awesome. Yeah.
We had a couple of good. Like then we did that Unconditional live. It's always been one of the best songs live when we started doing that. Like Art Cruz, like you know, who's now in Lamb of God. When we had him and he just knew what he knew how to fucking approach that song with like to get people just, it was just crushing, you know? Right. And even Alexi was before him. Like, you know, we were one of the live versions. We played Rock Hard Festival a couple of years ago and it, we allowed them to record it and they used it, their Unconditional on their, anniversary issue CD that just came out not too long ago. So that was kind of an honor, like, you know, to out of all so many bands that have played the Rock Hard Festival, for them to, like, you know, use a Prong track, you
that's
know,
cool.
Was,
yeah.
was really cool. But then it was Unconditional. So that's been a great track. And, you know, we put out a live bootleg record called Unleashed in the West.
I have that.
And that yeah, that's on there too. And yeah, that's a cool one.
There it is.
Yeah, there it is. Yes.
And your autograph is in this one.
Nice.
There's your
nice,
autograph.
Tim. Yeah.
Yeah, there it is.
Oh, super, you remember that?
Super dork.
Dude, shut the fuck up.
Well, the song.
So, yeah, you're right. I'm glad you pointed out that whole slow thing. That yeah, really, yeah. If we would have done that with Dotson, he would have been like, "That's fucking bullshit. Why would you slow something down?"
That's on Spotify, Eric. If you want, not the Unleashed thing, but there's an
they
album
took
called
it Down. Yeah,
yeah. There's an album called 100% Live that has.
That is all. I mean, that was a weird period for Prong. I don't like that.
Yeah. Well, it does have the Unconditional version on it. It's slowed down if you want
to. We did it on that one. I refuse to listen to that record.
You did do it because I was trying to find it. I was like, I got to find that ending of Unconditional somewhere. And I wanted a good recording or good ish.
We had a good sounding bootleg. Can I say that? Or is it? We get bootleg copies, but that's where I first started.
Yeah, Tommy's gonna be pissed because he bootlegged.
Yeah,
I'm sure he's. Well, there was no live yet. What were we gonna do? It's not like we didn't go to their shows. I mean,
we paid for the ticket.
Yeah, that's right.
We weren't selling the shit for a while.
Wound up like getting hired by somebody else. Like, was more popular, so that was like a problem. You know, we had like Blasco briefly and. You know, like all these guys, like Art now, you know, he's been stolen.
Yeah.
I know.
So, you know, it's been. Actually, Troy wound up in Killing Joke on one tour and they kicked him out.
Really?
What was that guy?
Ted did a tour with Killing Joke too and he got fired. So.
Oh, wow.
Oh.
Yeah.
Hmm. Real quick, I wanted to mention the Troy albums. One, I think you pronounce it Javiera. And then the other one was Snack Pack Juice Box. That was the really bizarre one, I think. Did those ring a bell? It's just weird, man.
He's a real artist. Like he does stuff just to do it. And I got to hand him it. And he's very talented and smart guy. His like lyrics were really good, etc. You know, it's I should check it out. I don't have the patience for it, really. But, you know. Well, I don't know if you've met him. Like, you know, he came. Mm-hmm. Actually on my birthday, we were on tour with AF with Agnostic Front. We were playing Detroit. I think it's Smalls was the place there in Detroit, and then he came by and we hung out all day. And I got like a year of Troy in one day with him. I mean, he just does not shut up. He's just, and then like, you know, like Stigma and Mirette Giraja are like backstage, and like backstage is this back room thing. And Troy's like, oh, God, you remember what the book? And he's like, I'm like, I had to go to Roger. I go, Roger, is he driving you crazy? Like, just let me know. I'll take him. And he's like, and Roger's like the nicest guy in the world. Like he talks to everybody. This lead singer from Agnostic Front, and he's like, "Yeah, could you just maybe give me like a 5-minute break?" You know, it's like I was like, "Troy, come outside. Let's hang outside. Let's go get some eat." You know, I was like, "You're driving everyone fucking." I didn't tell you you're driving everyone crazy, but he just goes, man. Like I don't know how we dealt with him on the road. He was like unbelievable. But his memory's unbelievable. He remembers the shit like that. I don't even fucking remember. Like I was wasted all the time back in those days. Anyhow, so that doesn't help.
Well, he contributed vocals on the album too. Like he sings all of
Get a Grip and Hell If I Could, and he did. Yeah. You know the answer on Prove You Wrong.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So yeah, I mean, we were trying to get him in the band. It's like, you know, another guy in there, but he was just he brought him into New York City, you know, like living there and like with all the drugs and the fucking chicks and the craziness. It was a bad move, man. Like he just ate it all up and he was just, you know, fucking, he was gone.
Yeah. Oh man,
it ate him. It ate him alive. And he'll say the same thing. He's like, dude, it really that was bad.
Yeah. Was he an Arizona guy?
He's from Detroit.
Detroit. Yeah, you said that. Okay.
I forget the whole story. He went to MIT, and he auditioned for Metallica, and he was one of the finalists.
Oh wow!
But they took Newstead, and that's how Flotsam found out about him.
Oh, okay,
makes sense.
Yeah,
gotcha. Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah,
yeah.
Huh. Well, you mentioned "Prove You Wrong." I think the song "Prove You Wrong," up to that point, that was one of the most different Prong songs I had heard for sure. Like the opening riff is unlike anything I'd heard from Prong before.
It sounds like Celebration Day.
Rip off of, yes, good call.
Yeah,
I didn't.
Yeah.
I read that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like, I have a certain like batch of influences, and I don't know if you know this, but like during my whole childhood and teenage years, I did not play guitar. Like, I picked up guitar. I was a bass player in bands, and Prong is, I guess I'm just. Within a year, like all my bag of tricks, I learned just off the cuff. So, I mean, I always loved Zeppelin III. I thought it was like a spooky record.
Yeah.
And, like, I was, I don't know. That was just so ingrained in me. And that's why I was like, and Ted was a huge Zeppelin head, like massive. So we were really into Zeppelin. We sort of like that record, even listening back, is like, as far as guitar parts, it's like a mixture of like Swans, Killing Joke, the Stranglers, Zeppelin, and then Metallica, sort of like an Anthrax. So sort of like all thrown in this mixed bag, that record.
Well, let me play a little bit of this.
Zeppelin is definitely always a huge thing,
Yeah, I'll play a little bit of this. I can play both. I actually have both pulled. Celebration Day.
The live version that we did on the Unleashed in the West is way better than this, I think, personally. Yeah.
Well, here's Celebration Day. There you go.
Yeah.
I can see that.
Yeah.
Kind of goes in a different direction, though, here.
Yeah, a little bit.
Changes a bit.
I'm afraid it's just a slightly better guitar sound on the Zeppelin record, and a slightly better guitar player than the song.
Yeah, I have to tell you a story.
You guys ever like do review Zeppelin records? You ever talk about?
We actually talked to Zeppelin III last year.
Mm-hmm. We did Zeppelin III last year.
One, because we don't do just 30 and 30 years, but
yeah, we did.
We did
30, 40, 50.
Yeah, we did. Because we were doing was 71, I guess, or 70, 1970.
Yeah. We did 70.
Last year we were doing 1990 albums, but then we switched. We ran out of 1990 albums, so we did 80
and
70. And
70.
And so we did Zeppelin III.
Yeah.
So.
That's badass. That's a bit of a coincidence, isn't it?
Yes, absolutely. It wasn't that long ago either. It was a few months ago.
Three months ago.
Yeah, something like that. I have to tell you a real quick story about Prove You Wrong. One of my fondest memories of a live show. First of all, the live show that we saw on that tour was you guys, Clutch, and Drown. And I think that was our introduction to Drown, I think, too, right?
It was. We didn't know who they were, and then we left that show.
I got there late. I missed them.
We bought the album immediately. Cause we're like, what the fuck was that? That was awesome. We're buying that.
But I got, and Clutch, of course, they're kind of hometown heroes for us, but they're amazing. But I got to the, right to the front for you guys, and you started playing this at the time, or shortly then before, I was in a band, and we covered the song Prove You Wrong. So I knew those lyrics, and Paul Raven sticks the mic in the crowd and it gets right to me and I'm doing the answer part. So you're singing, so I'm singing Troy's parts basically throughout the whole thing. And Paul just had them. Paul just stepped away. Like Paul Raven puts the mic in the crowd, looks at me. He's like, okay, go ahead.
And weren't you, Joe, weren't you in the bathroom?
Yeah.
And then you're like, that sounds like Eric.
That's funny.
That is Eric.
So thank you for that. That was one of my fondest memories from any live show. That was fantastic.
Where did we play?
That was the Bayou.
The Bayou,
The Bayou.
In Georgetown.
Love that.
We went to so many shows there because it was just basically just down the road from us.
Yeah.
And okay.
It was, yeah, and it was so easy to get into. It was so easy to park, and it was such a good setup, and yeah, we just loved
perfect
it.
Perfect size venue.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was cool.
Yeah. Missed that place.
It was very cool. Now it's a parking lot.
Those were the days.
Yeah.
Yeah. So many shows there.
Gosh. Oh, my God. So many.
Yeah.
What is it there now? What's there?
A parking lot.
It's a parking lot, yeah.
A parking garage.
Parking lot. Jesus,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I did a Google Earth on it one time, and I was like, oh, man. It's a road, and it's a garage.
It's been gone for a while. It's been
yeah, it's long. Yeah, it was bulldozed quite some time ago.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Sucks.
Yeah. I don't know. They did... there was a special, I forget who did it. They did a documentary on the bayou.
Oh, really?
Talking about the, yeah. I saw it last year. That's about all I can say about that, but
well, I'll look it up. Yeah. I would definitely watch that. Well, yeah. how many evenings have we spent?
You might be
there?
On it. Here.
Yeah. You could be on it.
Tim probably is for sure.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Just there like multiple times a week.
Oh yeah.
Sometimes.
So,
that's what we did back then. I mean, it was always something going on, and you know, people went out and they went to shows, and
yeah,
we go out on school nights.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, it didn't matter.
Didn't matter.
I couldn't drink, so it wasn't a big deal. You know,
right.
Yeah, so that was actually a really good tour, and I think Raven actually started singing the second part on "Prove You Wrong," and we used to do a dub version, not a dub like this. Weird remix version of that song, like that, because it was on after "Prove You Wrong." Like the label sort of realized, that's another thing, that the label felt they did not do a good job on promoting the record, and they wanted to do one of the first metal remix records. And we hang out with the records called "Whose Fist Is This Anyway?" And
yes,
there's a remix of "Prove You Wrong" on that, mm-hmm. But Jim Thirlwell. Of Scraping Fetus fame.
Yeah, G.G. Thirlwell. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
This is a remix. That's it. Yeah.
That's it.
So there's a remix, and Raven did the remix of Irrelevant Thoughts on that.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Nice. So that's how we became friends with Raven.
Oh, okay. Oh, cool.
But I reached out to him to do a remix, and then he was like, I want to be in the band, man. And I was like, really? It's like, big rock star, Killing Joke.
Yeah.
It's funny.
And he was there through Rude Awakening. That's it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Cause, yeah. Okay. So in the beginning of Hell If I Could, is that maracas I hear? Or is that an egg shaker or something going on?
Yeah. There's a platade. Another one is like, all gonna have these. Oh, there's Frankie LaRocco, our A&R guy, was talking about, oh, man, you got to use these eggs because he was a drummer.
Yeah.
So, like, that was his big contribution to the actual recording of the record. A&R guy, let him have his thing with his damn eggs.
There it is. Yeah. That's another Troy Gregory song.
Yeah, he sings the lead on that. Yeah.
Was he did he write that song too? Or was that like
No, we wrote it together. I mean, the lyric was his.
Gotcha.
That whole riff. I think the music is mine. Lyric and vocal was his on that.
It's kind of Voivod-ish sounding in a way.
Sounding like that, but it's really, it comes off, it's very Killing Joke.
Yeah.
And then there's a band called Chrome that we did a cover of Third from the Sun from them. And the chorus is reminiscent of one of their songs a little bit. But it's that song is an interesting groove. And it doesn't bother me that much, that song.
Yeah, it's got a really cool groove.
There's some songs on that record that definitely bother me.
Well, I was curious. You said there's a couple of throwaways. What would be the throwaways in your opinion?
I wanted to ask.
I'm like torn between. That Frankie LaRocco, our A&R guy, thought that was like was good. It's just it could have been good. It just needed a little love, like you know, like what producers should be doing. See, I hate bashing on it. Like a producer should be like, you know, I get rid of this part. you know, could you guys write a new part for that song part? Like right now, just fucking, was just like, all right, it's a, you know, this song's kind of a dud. We'll just record it and, you know, throw it on the record attitude. And it's just like, you know, come on, man.
Wow.
You know, it's, I get it. He didn't do any pre-production with us, which is another thing. Like, you know, it's like, I'm not going and coming down a week early on not getting paid. And, you know, I'm coming off another record. I'm coming right into another one. And I don't need to listen to the songs and need to do anything like that. It's like, no, some songs need love from a producer, need like to go, you know what? That line sucks. Write a different one. You know, no, you're not using that guitar on this song. You know, shit like that. That just did not go down on this record. Mm. So, I mean, that's the kind of stuff that you need, you know? And like right. That song didn't have the love, you know, Torn Between. And then No Way to Deny It is another one. It just goes on too freaking long, man. Like the, like, it's just, here we go with another verse kind of vibe, you know? It's like, yes, we heard it. And he could have just went, you know what? It's 4 minutes. Let's just make this one 3 minutes. Just get rid of that verse out, you know? We'll cut it out on the tape later or some shit.
Right.
Like, I mean, it's just obvious. It's like, you know, that we, and I don't know, what would we do? Maybe we're just drinking too much beer and we just like, we
wanted probably to get the regardless. Fuck out of
there. Right. Just wanted to get the fuck out of there. It's like one of those vibes, you know?
Yeah.
Ran out of money. Like,
is there any story behind your vocals on Brainwave?
Oh, okay.
They don't. Yeah, he's an HR. It's supposed to be HR from the Bad Brain.
Okay, that's what I figured.
Okay. Yeah.
That was all right.
That whole song, I mean, and I freaking love that song. People were just like, huh? Like, oh, what is this? Like, you know, it's a total tribute to the Bad Brain.
Well, yeah, I thought it was a Bad Brain's cover when I first heard it. I was like, is this a Bad Brain song that I've not heard before? What is this? Yeah, for sure.
It's definitely one of the best songs on the record. Like, Dotson hated it, didn't understand, didn't like the Bad Brains, didn't know anything about them, didn't care less.
That's why you
like, who the fuck are they? You know, it's like, you know. Yeah. He was one of those guys that thought Anthrax invented hardcore, you know?
Oh, no.
Like, wow.
So, anyway, the Bad Brains, I have pretty much invented hardcore. So it was a tribute to them. And, yeah, I mean, like, I fucking listen to that, like, the guitar parts and everything on that is just badass. I mean, I went a little too far on the HR impersonation. And we played it live. We used to play it live, and it didn't really kick ass that much, so we it never really got into the rotation. You know, band Power Trip did a cover of it, and they fucking just did a great job on it and destroyed it. So check their version out on that one.
That's good. Band.
Yeah. What was Get band? A Grip, it was like that didn't come out as good as I like it to. That was a Stranglers cover. You know, that was a little label thing. I was like, maybe you guys should do a cover. And, you know, I was like, well, what are we going to do? You know, it's like, and Ted and I being Stranglers fans were like, let's do a Stranglers cover. And people were just like, who the fuck are they? So it was just a waste of a song. Yeah. We never really made great decisions on those things. Like who we thought was popular, the rest of the, you know, populace never even heard of, you know. It's like, it's weird that way. We're just never on top of, you know, things, you know.
Well, speaking of that song, because I listened to the original, like, just to kind of get a sense. And, I mean, holy shit, the keyboards on that are just fucking all over the place. Then the saxophone comes in. What was it that possessed you guys to try and convert, you know, that one? I mean, it's a cool tune, but I would have... You know,
I'm with you, Keith. That's like, I don't know why we did a lot of things that we did back then. It's like and that being one of them is like, we thought we were smart and we were just dumbasses. And it's like, that's really what it was. And I'm serious. Like, we always thought we had this pompous artist attitude. Like, you know, we like the Stranglers and Einstein and Neubauten and, you know,
well, you weren't the only ones. I mean, Metallica were doing covers in their early days of bands that people didn't know about, like, you know, the new wave of British heavy metal.
But they were already big and they were slamming it and they were, you know, it was Metallica. Come on. Yeah. Like,
well, I'll make you feel better.
They can do
when we were in a band, we did the same thing. We would cover Nail Bomb songs because no one knew what the fuck they were.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
We
honestly, cover, I mean, go to Spotify. Go on Spotify and it says, like, if you like the other, because you go in Prong and goes,
yeah, you might like this band.
Yeah, Nail Bomb's number one.
Oh, really?
Yeah. For,
I mean, they're
the logarithmic thing. It's like Nail Bomb is number one.
Well, we did cover Nail Bomb and Prong songs. So.
Yes, we did.
And Gwar.
And Gwar.
Well, yeah, I mean, as far as wow. as far as my guitar playing goes, I have to thank you, Tommy, too, because the harmonics were like, I kind of emulated those as much as I could, because, you know, between you and Dime and like, I'm trying to think who else.
John Christ.
Oh, John Christ.
And John Christ. Zach,
of course. Yeah. But yeah, but this
well,
is
I mean, what I got it from Billy Gibbons is what I'm.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, the tush, the solos and tush, like the. Yeah,
like
the,
I said, I didn't play guitar as a kid. Like I would flow, I would pick it up and like be like, huh? And like when we formed the band, I was playing bass, and we just decided that I play guitar. So.
Yeah.
Between Primitive Origins and those records, you know, like I guess I was just doing tons of coke and just sucking at night, like. Figuring out how to play guitar or something. I don't know. I really don't remember how it happened.
You got high one night, woke up the next morning, you had a guitar in your hand and no idea where it came from. And that was that.
Nothing of this. Nothing was planned. No, but you know that prove you wrong comes from the word prong, right? Like you take out PR, middle O, NG, and it's sort of like combine prove you wrong into prong.
That's cool.
Oh. Okay, I didn't know.
I never knew that.
Yeah.
Huh.
Isn't that interesting? It's sort of like the Angel album cover. Angel logo goes, you could go upside down or upside, right? You know that logo?
Huh.
I know the Angel.
I know the Dio one.
I know the Dio one. It spells devil.
Dio, you can do that too?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, if you turn the Dio logo
sure
upside down,
name for it
spells
it.
Devil.
Yeah, there must be a name for it. And none of us are smart enough to know what it is.
Yeah, Mr. Nat, you don't know Angel? Mm-mm. The group?
No.
Sorry.
They
no.
were like the white answer to Kiss. Like there was Kiss and there was Angel.
Oh, wow.
And like they, you know, in Spinal Tap, they stole the whole, when Angel came out in these pods.
Oh.
And they had these huge hairs. So the guy, actually, this guy, Mickey Jones, the bass player, his big hair got stuck in the pod.
All right, I'm seeing
it
now.
Supposedly it was a wig and he came out. And nice. The pod was still in the wig. And yeah, then Punky Meadows was a guitar player who Zappa like made tons of fun of in some records. So you got to look up Angel, man.
I'm looking at their album covers, and yeah, I don't know if it's going to be something we're going to enjoy.
The Does it hold up? Went on to have a big success with a hair band called Jafria. So.
Oh, Jafria, yeah.
Keyboard player and Angel. Anyway, I didn't, yeah. But. Their logo goes upside down and backwards. Mm-hmm.
It's almost
not. I mean, but overall, we had like this little like fan club thing called Prongsters and on Facebook. And I started, some guy put up the cover, ironically. I mean, this is synchronicity in the world to put up a cover. Oh man, this is because somebody re released the record on black marble vinyl recently.
Oh.
I mean, all those records that keep coming out, that epic. Had out of being re-released and they don't seem to die, and that one came out and he was like, oh, it's my all-time favorite record. So this discussion on this record has been going on for ironically for a couple of weeks, so
well
oiled on the subject.
That's good.
I mean, I know I know you spoke about possibly doing something, and it probably won't happen with Ted and Troy, but like would there be, if you could without COVID, would you do like a 30th reunion, or not reunion, but like a 30th anniversary tour to play this album front to back, anything like that?
I would like to do it with those guys, but I don't know what everyone's old, and I don't know what everyone's health is like, you know, and people have been out of the game, you know, it's like,
Well, and I guess since you're not really huge fans of a lot of these songs, you probably wouldn't want to play them live.
Yeah,
another song I really like on that for some reason no one else liked was Pointless. On
that song is awesome.
I know. Oh, I mean,
the end of that song is fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. It's fucking heavy. And I'm like, why don't Everyone's so like, oh. It's like, I don't get it, man. It's like, I thought that was a fucking killer track, you know?
The breakdown. Here, I'll play the breakdown.
Yeah, it's awesome.
150-ish. This part?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. It's awesome.
This is Swan's influence.
Yeah. It's good.
Yeah.
Instead of just getting into these things, it's just like not like notes, not solos, but just like these.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm going to fast forward to the end here because you got this part.
Hi-hat.
Heads.
I love that.
Yeah. It's awesome. Yeah. That's just badass. Period.
Yeah, I love that.
It's almost like Godflesh meets.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It is. Yeah.
New York hardcore.
Yeah.
Yes.
And yeah. That bass guitar sound, and then you think of that, and then you go like to snap your finger, snap your neck. It's just like the complete opposite in the bass.
Yeah,
it's fuzzy on this album.
It's. I do not understand. And there was this, I remember the discussions on these things in the studio, and I was just like, maybe I don't, you know, I'm arguing with the guy that engineered Sin After Sin, you know, when, you know, right. Like, how can I do that?
Right.
It's like, you know, he's worked on Priest records, and I'm like, okay, he must know what he's talking about.
Right, yeah.
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 Now, when it comes to your band, that's what anybody knows, you know, don't let anybody tell you what you're supposed to sound like, you know?
Right.
It's like,
yeah.
That was the great thing about Terry was like, you know, he looked to me as the guidance and he made it happen. And then if something was really horrible, he'd say, that lyric is just, yeah. I'd be like, okay, I'll write something different.
Right.
Big deal, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, Terry Date has kind of, I mean, probably the best metal producer's got to be, right?
Like I think so.
Collection of albums that
there's
he's produced.
So many guys now that are great. Like, I mean, that in recent years, I mean, I'm not up on the deal, you know?
Yeah, well, I'm just talking about like.
Ones either.
Yeah.
Well, I know he produced the most recent Deftones album too, Terry Date did. That's really
good. Oh, did he?
Yeah. It sounds great.
Sounds great.
Yeah. So he's still in the game.
They brought him back. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It sounds great.
And it's so strange. You can tell it's him. It sounds like Deftones, but also sounds like a Terry Date album. And I don't know how he does that. It's so weird. I'm like,
yep.
How do you pull that off? It's crazy.
It's kind of stuff that you like. For instance,
knowing what you're doing.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's like what he uses, you know, like it's sort of like you could tell it's, you know, Ritchie Blackmore playing, you know, like Telecast. I mean, Stratocaster and his tape machine and Marshalls, you know. And,
is that what it is? Like, I mean, he just says, I use this equipment, like this board, this, and this. And this is kind of.
Probably. Yeah. I mean, it's like the same stuff that he uses. I don't know what he's doing now. I mean, like, but I don't even know if anybody goes into the studio anymore. I mean, the Deftones having tons of money, they probably do go into a regular recording studio.
Yeah.
It's like, I don't know.
Who knows?
You have to have some kind of dough to do that these days.
Yeah.
Considering, yeah, I mean, like, you know, you sell 50,000 records, you're like, Jesus, like, it's a big deal.
It's crazy.
You know, like, Prong selling, you know, like 75,000 Prove You Wrong records, they're ready to drop you back then.
Right.
You know?
That's crazy. So,
yeah. It's so weird.
Well, you're not getting money from Spotify.
Rock records used to sell a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's how you made your living, right?
Yeah. Touring and that. Yeah.
Yeah. So. Just real quick, we're at an hour. I want to make sure you're still cool to keep going for a little bit.
Yeah, let me see if my wife, Megan. you want to come in for a second? Do you need me? What's going on with him? I have a new son. I have a little baby.
Oh, congratulations.
Congratulations, yeah.
Come in.
I saw the crib next to you, and I'm like, I got a six-year-old and a four-year-old. So.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Look at that boy.
This is Tommy Jr., see?
Oh, very cute.
Got a Prong shirt on, see?
Nice, very cute. Nice. Hey, buddy.
You see that one? This guy's on there? You see that? They're talking about one of your daddy's records.
Hi. Is this your first podcast, Tommy Jr.?
First podcast.
Nice.
Nice, yes. We can claim that.
We'll have him back on in 3 or 4 years.
Yeah, right?
He'll we'll have him back on in 30 years. We'll celebrate the release of this podcast in 30 years, and we'll talk about that.
There you are.
Remember when you were a baby? And, no.
They both Tommy Victor's are here, see? So
there you go.
Sorry, guys, Nate.
I mean, we could wrap it up and, you know, say.
So, okay. Right? Yeah, that's cool.
Right. What, ask any. I'm not in any rush, but any other questions you guys have?
I had a question about some of the more recent stuff. You did a cover of Cortez the Killer, right?
Oh, yeah.
And then there's a song called Do Nothing. Was that song because you had done the Cortez the Killer song? Like, was that like, hey, I can do this. So I kind of take this kind of vibe and apply it to this. It's kind of like, it's not a ballad, but it's got that sort of more, I don't know, it prompted the ballad,
I totally forgot about that, that's true. Is because I was work with this guy, Chris Collier, this kid who's an absolute genius. And he, we did the vocals for Cortez the Killer. Like, I haven't really, my vocals have always been something weird. Like, I've always been insecure about it. And, doing a Neil Young cover, you can't sound like Neil Young.
No.
But... So I was like, I sort of tried to have, like, I almost sounded like a country and western singer or something on the cover of that.
I liked it.
Man, I'm really digging this, like, this just really singing thing. And then when we went in to do the No Absolutes record shortly after that, I was like, I'm going to use that voice again. And, a friend of mine, Erie Locke, he actually came up with the music to that, the keyboards, and I came up with the vocal. So I was like, why not, But, as usual, people like, huh?
I love that song.
I love that song. No, I loved it. I thought it was
that's
great.
A great song.
Yeah, I liked it too. I mean, I thought I was very happy with that No Absolutes record. Anyhow.
Oh, yeah.
I think everything from 2012 forward, everything at last.
Oh, thanks. Yeah. But that fantastic. Cortez the Killer thing, I mean, I was so psyched about that. I mean, Jason Christopher came up with the idea, let's do that. And I'm like, all right, cool, man. Well, how am I going to, do a Neil Young guitar part and vocal? It's like, you're going to do it. And he was like, I trust you. And we did that on the road, that record.
Okay.
And I was like in a hotel room. I'm like, how am I going to, I had a guitar, without an amp. Just, I'm like figuring out that whole guitar intro. And then we went home and did the vocal, after we cut it. We did that whole record in a day, that whole covers record.
Oh my God. That's crazy.
Yeah. It was insane. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
But I was really happy about that. That's why I went in and did that. Now I'm like, I don't even want to sing anymore. I just want to scream again.
If you sang again, I wouldn't mind. So I thought it was really good.
Oh, thank you.
I really liked it a lot. I thought it was really cool to hear that kind of that side of your vocal style. It's really cool.
The thing that came and developed. I mean, Steve Evitz helped me with that. Like when we started doing Carved Into Stone, he was like, he vocal trained me for a while.
Okay.
So,
Yeah,
this is the kind of stuff that producers do, they go out, they step outside their boundaries and try to help you out. And with Steve, I became a better musician, singer, everything after working with him. He helped me, it was really a great experience working with him.
Their name's on the album too. So you'd think they would want to.
Yeah.
Some of these guys get pumped. Like, look at Ruben. I heard he did. Went back for a while. I don't know what he does now. Like, Glenn was always saying, he didn't even show up. He was like, he came in and told the guys.
That's what Metallica said.
I saw Ruben twice during the recordings of, Lucifuge and stuff.
We talked to Craig LoCicero. We've had him on the show from the band Forbidden. And he was in another band, Man Made God, I think was the name of that band.
That's right.
And Ruben produced that album. He said the same thing. He's like,
yeah.
He came in one day and said two things and left, and then we never saw him again.
That was a big thing. See, that was the thing of, in the big time rock and roll of the age, I don't need to do anything. I just everything's a mail-in. I put my name on it and it's fine. Those days are over, obviously,
Yeah.
His protege, or whatever, Greg Fiddleman, that's his name, right, Tim?
Yeah, Greg Fiddleman. Yeah.
Yeah, he did the last two Metallica albums. I think they sound great. But
yeah, they do sound really good. He's a good producer. Yeah.
So he just taught that guy everything he knows and was like, all right, go at it, go have at it, do whatever. So
yeah,
Well, what are you working on now? I mean, it's been
nothing. I'm sort of staying
he's
home.
He's holding what he's working on.
Yeah, it's like my wife works and she's doing it now. And right now we're there's nothing going on anyhow. It's perfect timing because of the COVID situation.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
just hoping for another prong.
Well, I think we could do something different like the next time around. What I would do right now, if you talk to me, is if I had to answer you on that, because like I said, I was reading up on the old Sabbath records and how they did that. I mean, I think like the first Sabbath record is just—it's just mind-boggling how great that record is.
We just talked about that one recently.
Yeah, we did.
Really?
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
It sounds
50-year anniversary. It's crazy. Yeah.
Sounds unbelievable. The energy. And just everything is great about that record.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the first
like,
two. Are
they amazing. Just went in and did it. It's like, it'd be good to do, like I said, like, you know what? We're going to jam for a couple of weeks and then just go in and do a record. And if it's Pearl Jam has done that and it came out good, and whatever it is, that's what it is. Yeah. Something like that would be cool.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Well, yeah.
Better, like, you know, some of these songs, you now with digital technology, you know, you have your Pro Tools. It's like you take it home and then you make changes to it. Yeah. And then you re-examine it. Then it's like, oh, what do you guys think of this? And then, you know, it's like you're working on it in the computer for 2 months, 3 months. And then, you know, yes, that's true. And then
he agrees.
That's what I was thinking.
Anyway, that's about it, really.
Yeah. Well, we do this little silly thing on our podcast where we grade albums, where we give an A through F grade to the albums. Each of us give our own grade, so we're gonna do that with Prove You Wrong now. I can start. I'm gonna give
about doing this now.
Well, no, I'm gonna give it an A. I appreciate what you're saying, Tommy, but I still love the album, so I'm giving it an A.
Me too. A. It's an A because I love the album, and I don't care if it sounds weird. I still love it.
Yeah.
I'm going to echo that as well. I mean, I'm not the biggest Prong fan in the world. Sorry, but. I find it so amusing to hear you actually criticize it, because I just, you know, the staccato use, the just the groove of these things, just the obvious hardcore influences, it just makes this so this album is just so freaking brutal, and I love that. So
Keith, I think maybe of all the bands that we talk about that you never really got into, I'm shocked that Prong is not one of the bands.
Absolutely,
like right up out your alley.
That was one thing. I was like, you know, when back in the day when it came to buying a record, you know, you may have wanted to go in and buy, you know, Prove You Wrong, but you never knew when you walked in the store if they were going to have that. So it was always kind of a little bit of an experience, like as to what you were going to end up buying. You knew you were walking in to buy something, but you had no idea what it was going to be. And I used to keep business cards. Like in my wallet, you know, and I'd write down names of bands that I'd have, and Prong was like written on top of one of them. It was like number one. If they freaking had any of your stuff in the, you know, Kent Mill, we all know what Kent Mill I'm talking about.
Yeah.
You know, I would have walked home with it, but unfortunately it just never happened. So, I never owned.
Well, now you're getting to learn. Now,
yes. Well,
that's why we're here.
That was one thing. Like, you know, Joe, you mentioned, I know for a fact, I heard probably all of your stuff from your Walkman, Joe, like in high school. Like, you know, we'd, you know, trade off albums between classes.
Yeah, well, that's an interesting story. Because, I mean, like Steve Martin, who was a guitar player in AF, and like, you know, I know the guys in Agnostic for a long time, and he became a publicist. And then he came down to the listening party for Prove You Wrong. And he loved that record in the listening party because he says it wasn't completely metal, you know? You know, that's why guys like you, more like Prove You Wrong is like, people say it's their favorite record. The people that aren't really like, you know, strict metalheads, maybe the fact that it isn't that brutally, in my ears, heavy is for an advantage on the point of like, you know, having a broader fan base for that record. So that's fine. You know, it's like, at that time we were questioning thrash metal. Like we didn't want to go the route of Death and Possessed and, you know, those bands and, you know, then Forbidden you were mentioning and Testament. We said we can't compete with those bands. We got to do something else, you know, and that's how right, the dead for proving wrong, and then obviously cleansing is, you know, a completely different thing. It's like, so you know, we're always trying to, like, the only way we could survive was doing something that was able to, you know, just make us look, make us somehow different. And we were different anyhow. We really didn't fit in. I mean, we weren't really metal guys anyhow, really, you know. So it just worked out, you know, the way it is. And that's a good story, though.
That's what I always loved about the band, though, is, and I took influence from that myself as a, like, a young guitar player. Like, these guys aren't, like, they're not flashy. It's just fucking good riffs.
It's riffs,
and good songs, good catchy chorus. It's that's what I like, and that's what I want. You know, if we can do that in our band, let's do it. So
I guess we didn't mention Eric and Tim and I were in a band in high school as a three piece, and Prong, Clutch, and maybe a little Caius were like, that was like basically what we copied.
Yeah,
wow, that's amazing. So,
yeah. But the fact you guys were
had their shit, man. That was they just exploded, and it changed a lot of people's heads around. Turned to black. Clutch, obviously. I mean, you know, made you think of a Clutch. They did an audition, because I used to do sound at CBGB. I was the sound guy, and I used to do the audition nights too. So when people, bands did not know that I was the guy. One, it was between me and the doorman deciding who would pass.
Oh, wow.
So, like, if you were an asshole to me, like, I'd be like, they sucked, even if they were great. Like, but Clutch, they had to come up and do an audition night. And that was the first time I heard them. And I was like, these guys are unbelievable. And I was like, that's how we made for them. They go, we're big Prong fans. I was like, I know you guys. What? Really? So it was amazing that my first experience with them was Helmet, too. Was another band. They had to do a, when they had long hair, they did an audition night, and they did not sound like they did, you know, eventually too.
That's one thing I wanted to ask you about from your days at CB's, you know, actually manning the sound booth, whatever you want to call it. But considering you have some experience kind of mixing, I guess, did you ever try and, you know, during recording sessions, you know, as much as, you know, producers might have done what they're supposed to do in other cases, did you ever, you know, try your hand at
no, like again, you know, stepping on the toes of a Mark Dodson, you know, like that, this guy again that, you know, I think he was in on Who sessions, and you know, like I say, he worked for, I mean, his resume was unbelievable. Like, he was, you know, I mean, but yeah, well, actually I beg to differ. The whole gated snare thing was my suggestion, the gated reverb, because I always did that on the mosh parts at CBGB's, like with rest the bands, like Rest in Pieces had these like hip hop style, like hard parts. And I always would put this gated reverb in on there. So that's how I suggested that to him on that. And he liked that idea. The piccolo snare came in later, and you know, we're trying to be like 311 or something. How that happened. But I didn't really know my way around an SSL board. We had like this old Soundcraft at CB's. That's the only thing I knew. And this basic EQ on there, like, you know, getting behind doing anything on an SSL, which was the standard board in a studio back then, I wouldn't know what the fuck I was doing. So. Yeah, sure.
All right. If you're going to give this album a grade, what are you going to give it, Tom?
Who, me?
Yeah, you.
Yeah.
Wait, I didn't get
you.
You know what? I'll be generous. I'll give it a B.
Okay.
Oh.
Okay. All right.
That's good.
Joe, what about? Sorry.
He's done a couple of good songs on there.
I was prepared to come in with an A, but I've been talked down by Tommy. So A minus for me. I realize this now.
It's cool.
Well, do you have anything before we let you go? Anything you're promoting? Anything that you want to mention? You know, any website, anything like that?
Yeah, we got prongmusic.com, and we have shirts up there.
Okay.
And then just play us on Spotify as much as possible.
We've been doing that the last 2 weeks for sure.
So. Yeah.
Yeah, get those numbers up. I'm trying to break 200,000 a month, you know. It's like it's always hovering below there. It's the weirdest thing in the world. It's like, it's mostly snap your finger, snap your neck plays, you know?
It's pretty astounding
the difference between that song and like the next most played one. I was pretty surprised.
Exactly. It's like 10 million and then.
Yeah, it's crazy. Come on. Listen to that entire album. That Cleansing is amazing.
Oh, yeah.
I track my listens on last.fm. It's a psycho last.fm. And it tracks all your stats on Spotify. And I think in 2017, Prong was my number one most listened to.
Oh, my God.
If you can believe that.
I can't. I forget about the records. Like, we were talking about, like, there's been recent records. You know, if anybody hasn't known that, I mean.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not going to. I'm getting in trouble for saying things about, you know, our recent label. They did the best they could, but like, you know, that we've put out records and people do not know they exist, and we've been continually. Yeah, you do. You're in the scene.
Yeah,
you know?
I know.
Like these other people, like, you guys came out records, man. Like, when? Like, I know. Last thing I got was was Rude Awakening.
Oh my god!
There's been tons of records after that.
Really good records.
They're actually pretty good.
They're really good.
Yeah, really good. Yeah.
They're damn
good. Carpenter Stone, fantastic. Yeah. 0 Days, the most recent one. I love that album too.
Yeah,
so good. Yeah,
I like Scorpio. Go check those out. Nobody else does.
Oh, you still? Yeah, Scorpio Rising. You still like that album, Joe?
I do. I still do. I don't. You're not going to talk me out of that one. I still like it.
Some people like it. My wife loves it. I don't understand. But no, this has been great. I love you guys. Thank you so much for recognizing
record.
And I think the concept is fantastic. I may steal your concept to do a podcast one day. Just kidding.
Well, yeah.
you're always welcome to come back on ours.
Absolutely.
So. Anytime. Open door.
Anytime.
Trust me.
Yeah, if you ever talk about if you want a guest discuss, like any Sabbath record, I will.
We're doing.
Master of Reality. We got
Master
of Reality
coming up. Yeah. We're going to do that this year for sure. So.
Well, if you need a guest appearance, I mean, I'll say a couple words on that one. That one I've been listening to a lot recently.
We'd love to have you, man. That'd be awesome.
Absolutely.
Cool.
Yeah.
We will schedule when we do that around your schedule as much as possible.
Absolutely.
Sabbath, Purple, Zeppelin, Tall. Those are my. That's what I'm talking. Those are my bands as a kid.
Cool.
Nice.
So.
Well, thank you, man. We really
appreciate you guys. In touch then, man. Yeah.
Stay safe. All right.
All right. Yeah, you too, man.
Thanks.
Thank you, guys. Take hit me back anytime. All right. You guys
know
anything.
Awesome. All right. Okay. We'll do.
Thanks, guys.
All right. Thanks.
All right. Energy. Aggression. Power.
To sum it up, it's a vulgar display of power.
Heavy metal speaks to the anger and despair of teenagers today the same way that the blues used to speak to the despair and anger on the South.
Cutting it up big time.
Some cunt's recording this.